In today's video, we are going to look into chapter 11, types of banks. This is a chapter in 11th commerce textbook, Samachir Kalvi syllabus. So going into the introduction of the types of banks, we all know that there are different types of banks performing in different sectors, or they perform different types of activities, but the core activity is going to be dealing in money. So though they deal in money, each type of a bank satisfy different sectors. So that is why the study of the types of banks is essential for the 11th standard students to go ahead with. So first we are going to differentiate these types of banks on the basis of three classifications. First one is on the basis of function performed by the bank. Secondly, on the status which is given by the Reserve Bank of India. Thirdly, is based on the ownership pattern of the bank. So first let's get into the based on function of the bank. So based on the function, it has been divided into 11 types of banks. So under this 11, the first one is the central bank, which we have already been discussing it in the 10th chapter in detail. The various types of functions also has been discussed. Therefore, we are not going to see that again in this chapter. Moving on into the second type of bank is the commercial bank. These are banks which basically accept the deposits from the public and they give loan to third parties like traders, or other personalized loans are also being given to the general public who have an account in their bank. And why do they give these loans? Is that is the only source through which they earn and profit. They earn an income for themselves. So these are called as a commercial bank. So if we see the lending capacity of these commercial banks are comparatively very small and mostly short-term and medium-term loans. That is, short period loans and medium period loans are given by these commercial banks. They also provide us with other services like remittance of funds or safekeeping of or locker facilities, in short, locker facilities, collection of the checks or other negotiable instruments, issue of letter on credit. So these types of services, extra services, are also being provided by these commercial banks. They usually operate with a head office and a network of branch offices under it, which will be spread throughout the country. Another subsidiary service what they do is they stand as a guarantee to businessmen when they get into a very large transaction. For example, if a businessman is getting into a big contract of purchasing machinery, the bank stands as a credit guarantee for that businessman and ensuring that the businessman will repay the amount to that particular person. So this is a subsidiary service which that particular commercial bank performs. So some of the examples of commercial banks are State Bank of India, Karur Vysya Bank and Standard Chartered Bank of India. Thirdly is a development bank. So these banks are also known as industrial banks. So if you take the main aim of these banks, as the name goes itself, it is not the profit which is going to be the main aim of a development or an industrial bank. It is going to be the development of the economy or the development of the society. So these banks do not aim on making a profit. They aim only to develop the country and to create certain employment opportunities to the public. So what kind of service they provide is, they provide investment, they provide modernization of big industries, and they grant medium and long term loans ranging from 5 to 20 years. So comparatively with a commercial bank, a developmental bank gives a larger amount for a larger period of time. So how do they get money to give it as a loan? Because they are not going to be banks accepting deposits. They are not commercial banks. So developmental banks, how they perform is, they are going to subscribe or buy shares and debentures of the industries, and they provide certain technical and managerial consultancy services through which they earn from the industrialists. So IDBI Bank, which was established as a main core apex developmental bank in the year 1964, and then it was transformed into a public sector commercial bank in the year 2004. So currently, this IDBI bank performs both the developmental bank function and the commercial bank function. So its name was changed into IDBI Limited in 2008. So when a development bank is established for development of agricultural industry specifically, it is called as an agricultural development bank. So National Bank for Agriculture and Rural Development is such a kind of a bank which is exclusively opened out to develop agriculture. So some of the examples of the development banks are IFCI, that is Industrial Finance Corporation of India, SIDBI and Mudra Bank. So these are some of the examples of development banks. Fourthly is going to be the cooperative banks. The cooperative banks of our country, India, has been owned by its customers. That is voluntary association of members who have joined together into a cooperation. So they own these cooperative banks, or you can term them as members of a farming society or a small trading society. So these cooperative banks in India are either operated in the urban or in the rural based community or the society. So if you take these kind of banks, they have a three tier or three subdivisions of providing loans. So you have one division which provides a short term loan and two subdivisions for providing a long term loan to its members. So these banks in Tamil Nadu are going to be registered under the Tamil Nadu Cooperative Societies Act of 1983. But lending out loans to them in short term or long term is going to come under the apex control of the NABARD, that is National Bank for Agricultural and Rural Development. They are controlled both by the RBI and by the State Government of India. So their foremost or the main objective of a cooperative bank is to provide loans for agricultural development, and it is not going to be about earning profit. So these kind of banks are set up in small towns and villages to improve their agricultural facility in them, and they are not concentrated that much in the city side. Then, comparing to the commercial bank services, these cooperative banks do not provide that much of services to its members because the laws do not allow them to do so as such as a commercial bank activity. The NCDC, the National Cooperative Development Corporation, which was established in 1963, is providing loans and grants to the state governments financing cooperative societies. So the kind of projects which they invest in or they give loan for is projects like water conservation, irrigation, agricultural insurance or rural sanitization. So these are the projects which these cooperative agricultural banks or these NCDC is taking up to give them a loan. So some of the example is Tamil Nadu State Apex Cooperative Bank. Head office is in Chennai. You have the Madurai District Central Cooperative Bank Limited. So next, moving on, we have the foreign banks. Basically, these are banks whose head office is in a foreign country and they have their branches spread throughout our country in our India. So these banks are known as foreign banks. These banks are mostly situated in big cities and port towns or in central places, and they serve the interest of multinational corporations, that is MNCs, the employees working in the MNCs and other business institutions. So if you take the profitability comparing to the other banks, it is very high for these foreign banks than the Indian banks which are operating within India. So in 2017, there were 42 foreign banks in India and all of them were scheduled banks. So these banks, though they have their head office in a foreign country and they have their branches situated in India, they have to oblige for the rules and regulations which the Reserve Bank of India gives them. They cannot do anything apart from the rules and regulations which are given by the Reserve Bank of India. Some of the examples of foreign banks are Bank of America, where the head office is situated in the USA, and the Dutch Bank, where the head office is situated in Germany. Next, moving on to the sixth point is the Regional Rural Bank, that is RRB. So this bank was formed under a Regional Rural Bank Act of 1976. It was jointly formed by the central government and by the state government and a sponsor bank. So these banks play a supplementary role to a cooperative bank, that is side by side role with the cooperative banks, and their main objective is to develop the rural economy and the type of share capital which is being contributed by the sponsorship bank is in the ratio of 50:15:35. Therefore, the cost of establishing this institution in the rural area is very, very less when compared to the other banks. So these banks operate by getting deposits from the rural public and provide loans to the rural artisans or small scale traders, so that they will not depend on third party money lenders. So as on 31/3/2016, there were 56 RRBs in India with 14,495 branches. These branches and these banks are regulated and supervised under the NABARD. So some examples are the Pallavan Grama Bank. You have the Paduvai Bharathiyar Grama Bank, Villiyanur, Puducherry. So these banks, out of their name itself, we know that these banks are established in villages to help out the village society or the people living in the village not to depend on money lenders, and they can freely go into this bank and get loans depending on their necessity. Next, we have the specialized banks. So from the name itself, we can tell these banks are established for a special purpose. So in India, we have these specialized banks for improving our international trade. So these banks deal with exports and imports. So we have an Export and Import Bank of India, which was set up through an Export Import Bank of India Act in 1981. So if you see the main objective of this particular bank, it is to facilitate a smooth flow of international trade of the country. So this Exim Bank or Export Import Bank provides a various types of services which will facilitate the flow of goods from one country to another, that is exports or imports. So what they do is they give finance for importing technology, exporting product development, shipment, pre-shipment, post-shipment, overseas investment, etc. So National Housing Bank was established under the National Housing Bank Act of 1987. This particular bank was owned as a subsidiary of the RBI, as a subdivision of the RBI. The objective of this NHB, National Housing Bank, is to provide housing finance to institutions which are located in regional levels in India. So this is also a special bank which is being covered. So we saw two types of special bank. One is a special bank for exports and imports, that is the Exim Bank of India, which was established by the Act, Export and Import Act of 1981. Another set of banks which we are going to see is the National Housing Bank, which provides housing loans to the people who are regionally located. So these banks are one such examples because they are established for a special purpose. Next we have is a local area bank, that is LAB. So this particular bank or the scheme is introduced by the RBI in August 1996. They are a small private sector bank which is established in rural or semi-urban areas. So each of these banks have two or three districts joined up with them. So if you take the main objective of these banks is to accept the deposit and invest them in small areas. So it is not about providing loans. The bank itself is going to invest or sponsor some small areas. So these local area banks are very difficult to establish because upon the application received, the RBI scrutinizes it and the RBI has to give license for these LABs to establish themselves. So they received 227 applications, out of which were 10 considered, and out of the 10 considered also, only 6 were given approval to open up their banks according to Section 22 of the Banking Regulation Act by the RBI. So now currently, if you see, there is only 3 local area banks functioning, and the 3 are the Coastal Local Area Bank, Vijayawada, Andhra Pradesh, Krishna Bheem Smriti Local Area Bank, that is in Telangana, and the Subhadra Local Area Bank in Maharashtra. So these are the 3 local area banks which have been established and perform and running by the RBI. So you may wonder the reason why they have stopped licensing or giving permission to these LABs to be approved to start business or to start bank is even after years of establishing these LABs, they were not able to make an improvement in the rural development. Therefore, these approval of LABs has been stopped by the RBI. Next, moving on point is the small finance bank. So small finance banks are private sector banks. These banks are set up in those areas which are which do not have any bank facility or which are underbanked. For example, if we have an area, at least in that area we'll have the nationalized bank and the scheduled banks over there, that is SBI, Indian Bank, Canara Bank. We may see those branches located over there. But if an area doesn't have that much of branches of these nationalized banks or the scheduled banks, in those kind of areas you'll have the small finance banks. So if you take the main objective of these banks is to accept the deposits and to provide credit facility to small and marginal farmers, to small scale industries, or to unorganized sectors. So some of the examples of these small finance banks are ESAF in Kerala, Ujjivan again in Karnataka, and Fincare in Ahmedabad, Gujarat. So next we have is the payment bank. So payment banks are formed to widen the spread of payments and financial services to small scale business holders, low income households, and migrant laborers. So these payments bank, they provide a very large service to us. That is, they will give us doorstep banking. You can access them through mobile, you can access them to online banking. They will provide us with ATM cards, they will give internet banking, you can transfer your funds. So some examples of these payment banks are Airtel Payment Bank, Paytm, we have India Post Payment Bank. So we would have used these payment banks. The main aim of it is they do not accept any deposit, but you can make payments to other services through these banks. Next we have is the Multilateral Development Banks, MDBs. A multilateral development bank is a bank which is formed by the governments of different countries or a group of countries. So in this bank, you'll have donor countries, that is countries who donate money towards this bank, and you'll have countries who borrow money from this bank. So this is actually a bank which operates between many countries. So this is the last point on the bank types of banks based on function.